This is One on One.
The hardest part about my dad having ALS was that there's no medicine that could cure it. You just have to wait and hope.
Being diagnosed with ALS is like being pushed out of a skydiving plane and wondering if your chute will open or if you will just hit the ground at high speed.
You go from a totally functional human being and all of a sudden you can't do things like shake hands with somebody. You couldn't tell me or convince me that there was anything that I couldn't do. And right now, I'm beginning to wonder tomorrow if there's anything I can do.
We're honored to have Donna York with us, the founder and president of an organization called HARK, which is named after?
My dad. My dad, who was given the name as a child and was the only way my mother ever referred to him.
His nickname is HARK, Charlie HARK Dorney.
Dorney, yes.
And what were we just watching? A film?
That was actually the trailer for a documentary that we filmed. I lost my dad in 2009. And when the doctor called to tell us what it was, after 18 months of trying to find out what was wrong with him, that's him.
That's your dad. Go ahead.
That's definitely him. He said, "I believe your father is ALS and I wouldn't wish it on my worst enemy." And so we watched for the next 18 months as he lost his ability to walk, talk, breathe, swallow, eat. And he was really one of the strongest people I have ever known. So to see what that disease did to him, it was just heart-wrenching. And so in 2011, a friend of mine came to me, and actually her husband was Art Anderson, who was in the film.
And the name of the film is?
Hope on the Horizon.
Hope on the Horizon, go ahead.
Yes. And she said, "You know, Don, I think my husband has ALS, but he had lost the ability to use his hands and he was out of work. They didn't have any insurance. Their house was in foreclosure. And so he wouldn't go to the doctor." So long story short, he was diagnosed with ALS. And, you know, my thought through this with her was we had all the resources we needed to take care of my father. He was a veteran. ALS is a service-related disability. So we had benefits from that. He was very, what we say, frugal. So he saved a lot of money. He had a pension. We had seven kids to take care of him. We were able to keep him home. And then I have, on the other side of this poor woman who had to quit her job to take care of her husband, didn't have anything. And so I sort of looked out there and said, okay, is there anybody out there that helps these people? And I really didn't find too many organizations that provide financial support. So that's what we did, and that's why I started HARK. But the dilemma was, how do I raise money for a disease that nobody knows anything about?
And this was pre-Ice Bucket Challenge.
Yes. Yeah, 3 years ago.
Wow.
And even when my father was, suffering with it, everyone kept saying, "Did your father have a stroke? Did your father have a stroke?" And I'm like, "No, he has ALS." And then they look at me and I'd say, "Lou Gehrig's disease?"
Because
that's how people know it. But nobody ever saw Lou Gehrig with a feeding tube, a trach tube, not being able to move anything but his eyes. You know, he just gave his famous speech. And I love Lou Gehrig. I mean, he was, a great man, but he gave his famous speech. And he walked off the baseball field, and his wife never let anybody see him like that.
You know, that's the irony of this. The reason you're in the studio is because, it's true, I wrote a column on Lou Gehrig as someone who gave an extraordinary speech at Yankee Stadium that moved people. And people wrote in, and you were one of the ones who said, "You didn't get it right, Steve."
Yeah.
You said, "Steve, you got it wrong," because you stopped the story with the speech, and there was so much more that people needed to know about ALS. And in some ways, while it was no disrespect to Lou Gehrig, you said that I needed to tell and we needed to tell the rest of the story, which is what you're doing.
Yes. Well, it was also because when you wrote the column, you kept referring to him as having a fatal illness, but never said ALS. And never said what ALS was. And the one thing in the ALS community is to raise, I mean, obviously the Ice Bucket Challenge now has brought this really out into the public eye.
Has it helped?
You know, it has, because people are talking about ALS, but to be honest with you, I really wonder if I walked out on that street right now and said, "Did you do the Ice Bucket Challenge?" And people said yes, and I said, "What's ALS?" I'm not sure they really...
So what do we need to do?
A picture's worth 1,000 words. I mean, you can sit here and talk about ALS forever and how devastating it is and debilitating and what it does to people, but especially in our documentary, there's a gentleman named Martin Wallum who got it when he was 41 years old. No, 30, I'm sorry, 31. He's now 41. He can only move his eyes. That is it. He's being kept alive by a trach tube, a feeding tube. He's in a chair that basically he gets transported in. And he has a, you know, 10, 11-year-old son. And this is his life as long as his life lasts.
We need to see this?
Yes.
Why?
Because you need to see it. People need to see ALS. They need to put a face, you know, to the disease. And not just one face, but people think this disease is so rare. And, I mean, I'm telling you, if you just go out and say, do you know what ALS is? They might say, no, but my uncle so-and-so had it, or I lost this person.
Not that rare.
It's not.
What do you need for us to do in the time we have left? What do you want people to do once we learn more?
Well, I want people to, when they're thinking about where they're going to give their charitable dollars at the end of the year, I want them to look to an ALS organization. But I want them to look to one that, obviously I want them to give it to HARK. That's why I'm here, and there's not a lot of organizations that help patients financially. But research is also important, too. But just do your homework. Go to GuideStar. Go to these, or, you know, these websites that rate nonprofits, and make sure you're giving it to somebody that's actually really using the money for what.
I am so glad you wrote in after I wrote that column. I'm so glad that you are doing what you're doing and that you joined us here in public broadcasting to share your story, which is the story of a lot of other people. And I encourage everyone to go out and see this movie and check it out. Keep doing what you're doing.
One-on-One with Steve Adubato has been a production of the Caucus Educational Corporation, celebrating over 25 years of broadcast excellence. This special edition of One-on-One with Steve Adubato is brought to you from the Tisch WNET Studios at Lincoln Center. Funding has been provided by Hackensack University Health Network, County College of Morris, New Jersey Council of County Colleges, MD Advantage, activists in cooperation with the American Medicine Chest Challenge, TD Bank, and by PSE&G. Promotional support provided by Commerce Magazine and by New Jersey Monthly, the magazine of the Garden State, available at newsstands. Transportation provided by Airbrook Limousine, serving the metropolitan New York, New Jersey area.